So why do you believe this shooting was justified?
Well, Chris, I think if you look at the whole situation, look at the whole story with an open mind from start to finish, you look at the officers dealing with Mr. Brooks in a very calm and peaceful manner for about 43 minutes. And then you see it suddenly change when they tell Mr. Brooks he's under arrest and begin to put the handcuffs on. Mr. Brooks becomes violent and begins to attack the officers.
All right. So let's go step by step. I'm with you. There's a lot of chit chat, a lot of niceties for a long time. What about the benign option of the guy says he's going to walk home? He's got a sister in the area. You know, he's not far. He'll leave the car here. He'll go. Why not give him the option of letting him leave that way? Leave the car here, walk home. Or maybe we'll give you a ride if we're leaving, whatever. Why not go that way?
All right. The officers have lots of options available. They chose to make the DUI arrest. Who's to say that he's going to say, I'm going to walk home and then come back as soon as the officers drive away and take his car and go out and kill somebody driving DUI? You know, that's a liability we take when we leave somebody at the scene. You leave somebody that's DUI at the scene with a car, or even if he walks away, who knows that he doesn't have another key if you take his keys? Mm-hmm. You don't know the facts. You don't know what's going to happen.
Right. He was pretty clearly intoxicated, and he was reported as intoxicated to them. Why'd they let him drive the car in the parking lot if it was such a no-brainer that it was a DUI arrest?
They had him move the car to a space, which was only about 20 feet away. So moving it out of the drive-thru, they were still in the investigative phase, okay? At that point, they're not sure that he's DUI. They're investigating it, but they're not sure he's DUI. It's not till they do the tests and determine that they believe him to be under the influence of something, and they're going to place him under arrest.
Okay, so now they say, we're going to place you under arrest. Everything goes sideways. He resists. There are now two of the officers, and when I watched this video, and please, Mr. Gaynor, I had you come on for your candor, okay? You know this stuff better than I. I have spent a lot of years doing self-defense and different kind of suppressive movement training, literally over a dozen years. When I watch these two officers trying to take him down, I don't see a lot of adeptness by them. They're really struggling with this one guy. I don't see any evidence of super strength by him or him being drugged up in a way. Maybe he was, maybe he wasn't. What kind of training do the officers get in using non-deadly force in how to apprehend somebody?
We do get training. Almost every year, we have annual training in which they train how to take somebody into custody. But, you know, every person is different. Every person is different in the way they fight. Mr. Brooks, I think, was very strong. I think he was able to surprise them when he all of a sudden attacked them, and he took them to the ground, which is not a good position for the police to be in. An officer does not like to be on the ground. He punched them, which is an assault upon the officers when he began punching them. I think it was just a knockdown, drag-out fight at that point until Mr. Brooks grabbed the taser.
So he grabs the taser and runs away. Why do you think that part of the fact pattern, him running away with the taser, that he apparently reaches back, I don't know which arm we'll watch in the video, but reaches back with the taser, discharges it, and that's when the officer chasing him fires at him several times, hitting him at least twice. Why was that okay?
Well, to finish on the fight part, they tell him not to take the taser. They tell him, let go, and he refuses. So he now steals the taser from the officer, gets up, and runs. Mm-hmm. He does fire the taser. It does appear to hit the officer when you watch it. You do see the flash of the taser. You see the officer bounce off the car. And at that point, I think the shots are fired about the same split second that it's occurring. Now, the back shots are just the way he's positioned when the shots go off, whether he's turning back around or whether he was turned in a twisted mode where his back
was running away. This is a huge part of the fact pattern. The idea that the shots were just put where his body was positioned is being a little too forgiving, I think, in the analysis. Shooting someone from behind is not what you are trained to do. Isn't that correct?
You can't predict how a person's going to bob and weave and where the bullets are going to go after it leaves your gun. If they're facing towards you and the reaction time that you have, you fire, they could turn around. Your reaction time is a lot slower than their reaction time. They know what they're going to do. You have to react to what they're going to do.
But he never turns around. He's just running away and twists his body and fires what they knew to be a taser because they knew he didn't have a handgun on him. They'd already searched him. And a taser doesn't count as deadly force when you guys use it. So why does it become one when he uses it?
When we use it, a trained individual using a taser is not a deadly weapon by Georgia law. So a trained individual knows where to aim the taser. An untrained individual does not, and it becomes a deadly weapon at that point. And
that's not in the law. Where do you get that from?
Well, I get it from the training then, okay? So the training that we've had for over 20 years tells us that if they take your baton or your taser, it now becomes one step more that you have to use deadly force, because those can be used against you to incapacitate you and then take your weapon. And if you look at the district attorney from Fulton County, 2 weeks ago, the taser was a deadly weapon. This case, the taser is not a deadly weapon. So, Mr. District Attorney, you've got to make up your mind. Is it or isn't it a deadly weapon?
What case
because
was it
really
a deadly weapon?
It was the case with the two college students in the protest down in the city of Atlanta, in which those two officers were fired and then arrested by the district attorney only before the investigation was even complete.
I understand why that was frustrating to a lot of officers, and I know it took the chief by surprise. I don't remember the taser being a fundamental part of the analysis there. It was the method of which the kids were removed, and the officer, who I believe may have been an officer who wasn't the initial one dealing with them, but came in and picked up one of the kids, suspects, and threw him on the ground and had to have another officer tell him to back off. I don't remember that being about the taser, but let's go one case at a time. This case comes down to that last moment, I believe, in my legal analysis, and that's why I'm interested in your take on this. All right, he has the taser. Maybe it's a dangerous thing. Maybe it isn't. It has to come down to how it's used. It's fired over a shoulder and turned with someone who is clearly running away in a parking lot where there are all these families and stuff and parked cars. That's a good decision from an officer to start firing at that person running away in a parking lot that's filled with cars with people in it.
I don't know from the video, Chris, what his backdrop is. Obviously, the officer felt it was a safe environment because we had trained to look at the backstop. So if his backstop was clear and he felt comfortable in the shot, that's probably why he took it. But I can't tell from the videos what the backstop
being comfortable taking it is different than it being okay. Some officers have described this as maybe lawful, but awful in terms of choices. Do you really believe you can justify shooting a man multiple times in the back while he's running away when you know where he lives? You know, aren't you guys trying to protect life?
I think you can justify this case by Georgia law. It specifically gives him the right, based on the aggravated assaults and the threat he poses to the public and to the officers there. It specifically gives them, by law, the right to shoot him. He chose to make those actions. He chose to do what he did. He could have been like 100 other DUIs that night, got arrested, bonded out, and gone home to his family.
But resisting
but he
arrest,
chose something else.
But resisting arrest, as we both know, is not a death sentence. And you're right. Mr. Brooks made choices that were bad choices. The officers are trained in de-escalation, and they're supposed to be protecting and serving. Maybe under the law, an officer may be deemed to have had the right. But do you think what he did was right? Would you have done the same thing in that situation?
I can't tell you, Chris. I wasn't there. I'd have to experience the whole thing. I don't think that either one of us can say not being there. We can quarterback this thing all day long, but we weren't there.
But you worked on the streets. You were in tough situations. You ever fire at anybody who was running away from you without a gun?
I didn't have to use my weapon after 30 plus years. I was very good. I didn't have to use my weapon. I was pretty good at talking. I got out of a lot of serious situations with people with weapons. I was lucky. A lot of officers are not that lucky, and they have to do what they have to do to go home. And you have to look at it from their point of view. This is
we both know he could have gone home if he hadn't fired at him, and he'd still have a job if he hadn't fired at him.
We don't know what would have happened.
He was running away, Steve. What was going to happen? He was running away.
Chris, what's he going to do when he runs away? What's he going to do? Now we know what the criminal history is, but we didn't know that at the time. But could he carjack somebody? Could he be scared so much that he's going to kidnap somebody in another car? Is he going to?